We are nearing the end of this long module on constraint-based modeling of metabolic networks. So, I will give you a quick recap of all the concepts we have done so far, beginning with the stoichiometric matrix, the constraints one imposes on metabolic networks, and what are the possible choices for the objective function. So, welcome back. Let us recap constraint-based modeling today. We studied a whole lot of techniques and a whole lot of applications for constraint-based modeling. So, let us try to recap it to make sure we have understood everything. So, why did we go in for constraint-based modeling in the first place? Right. We essentially said that it is very difficult to model very large systems using kinetic modeling, because there is no question of estimating, like if you have 1500 reactions in E. coli, you cannot estimate Vm and Km for each of those reactions. So, not going to be estimating about 3000 parameters. Although there are ways to build, you know, genome scale kinetic models, it always depends on the ability to accurately estimate parameters or have prior estimates for parameters. In the absence of that kind of information, it becomes very difficult to simulate genome scale kinetic models or even estimate parameters for genome scale kinetic models. So, given that, the first thing that we went ahead and looked at was how do we formulate the system. So, the classic formulation we started with was right, where x is nothing but a vector of metabolite concentrations, s is your stoichiometric matrix and V is your flux vector. Right? You can have internal, external fluxes, everything inside of this vector. Right? So, for each of these, you could actually write kinetic equations, right. So, dx by dA by dt, you can have a kinetic equation. It will be some k into A minus k2 into B and so on and so forth, right. So, let us just visit the stoichiometric matrix again. So, this is going to be S m cross R. M is number of metabolites, R is number of reactions, right. Now, let us just think for a moment, let us consider the matrix S cap, which is, you know, in MATLAB terms, I would just say, or essentially a binarized version of the stoichiometric matrix. What is going to be the size of this matrix? And S cap transpose . What do these two matrices tell you?
Sir, an adjacency matrix for substrate graph.
More or less, right? It actually tries to tell you. So he was saying that whether this is asking if it's an adjacency matrix for a substrate graph, and it's more or less that. So what this gives you is, it tells you the incidence of every metabolite in every reaction, right? So, it now will connect metabolites that are, you know, linked to one another, literally the substrate graph, right. And what is the diagonal? That is why it is not a substrate graph. So, what is the diagonal? The number of reactions a metabolite participates in, right. So, that is going to be the diagonal. So, you can think of what happens when you multiply S cap transpose into S cap as well, right. These are two interesting matrices. And in fact, the most interesting matrix is, of course, the stoichiometric matrix itself, and there are several spaces associated with this matrix. So you should go and read about it, the you know, the left null space and so on. So in fact, all our interest vectors of interest belong in the left null space of S, which means that SV equal to 0, what are all the V's that satisfy this equation of SV equals 0, right. So this is the first place where we started. So now what are your constraints? We said this is constraint based modeling. Where do you get your constraints from? So we said we will impose different kind of constraints. The first important set of constraints is what we already have here. Essentially at steady state this becomes SV equal to 0. What is this constraint? Mass balance. Steady state mass balance, right. What are the constraints did we impose? Some lower bounds and upper bounds. This also accounted somewhat for thermodynamics. What were the constraints on the E. coli core model? Yes, SV equals 0. Yes, we put some lower bounds and upper bounds. What else? We did feed the model something, right?
Glucose.
Right. So, what are the medium constraints or exchange fluxes, right? What are your medium constraints versus exchange fluxes and so on, right? So you had a cell, you said you take so much of glucose, so much of O2, some biomass, some CO2 and so on, and of course there is a complex metabolic network that is going on here. Right. But what you have are a glucose uptake flux, an oxygen uptake flux, any other uptake fluxes and whatever secretion fluxes, CO2, you know, net ATP generation, consumption, whatever. Right. And another very important constraint that we briefly discussed was, another important constraint we briefly discussed was that of ATP production. Or what is usually called the ATP maintenance, MATP or ATPM reaction in many models. Most models have this. This is literally calibrated, right? It's made to fit experimental data. Right? You say something like my minimum ATP non-growth associated maintenance ATP is 0.5 of this sort. This is the constraint that is there actually in the E. coli IAF 1260 model. What does this mean again? Do you recall? So the cell requires some energy, some ATP over and above what it requires in metabolism. Whatever is there in metabolism is kind of captured in these constraints, right? Essentially here, right? But the cell has some ATP requirement that goes over and above this for survival, and this is called non-growth associated maintenance, and this is pooled into one flux. So this is, how does this translate mathematically? infinity or let's say a large number.
Why don't we put that in the upper bound, lower bound itself?
Yeah, that's what this is. Right? So this is LB, this is UB. So this constraint becomes important. But now there's a potential catch, right? As always in this course, let's try to emphasize on practice rather than theory. What happens when you actually try and simulate this? So what happens if, okay, so let's just recall, so maybe we'll come back to it in a moment, right? What is the vanilla FBA formulation? This is what we just had on the previous screen. It is maximize C transpose V such that SV equal to 0 and why did we go here? Because we said this is a fat matrix with infinitely many solutions. You need to pick one solution. And this we said was identical to the, you know, simple problem we used to solve in school about, you know, a factory making tables and chairs, right? So that instead of tables and chairs, we now have several metabolites, and instead of profit, we have an arbitrary objective function we pick, right? But usually we pick the objective function of, so now the next important thing is, choice of objective function. What are the possibilities? Maximize growth or minimize ATP consumption, minimize nutrient consumption, maximize some product. Like lycopene, the LP case, these are the objective functions, right? So what do each of these translate to, right? So this tries to capture a cell growing under maximum nutrient conditions. This, these two probably try to capture growth under starvation, what about this? This captures a possible metabolic state where lycopene is maximized, right? So out of these, this is a little different, right? Maximize growth is good in the sense it's able to capture really what's happening, right? And maybe to some extent, these also capture what's going on within the cell. But this is not necessarily what happens within the cell, but it tells you that under a particular condition, this can very well happen. Right? Or if you want to maximize lycopene, this is the kind of rerouting of fluxes that must occur, and maybe you want to figure out how to perturb the system to really get there. Right? So that is what, so this is a possible scenario, and at this point recall what? That your V bio star is unique, right? But the flux solution, right, the vector itself can vary. C transpose V is unique. Is that fair enough? Important to remember this. So in today's video, we started off with a recap of constraint-based modeling of metabolic networks. We revisited the concept of stoichiometric matrix, what are all the constraints on a metabolic network, as well as how we go about picking a good objective function for our simulation. In the next video, we will look at how metabolic networks can be perturbed, what kind of perturbations are done, and how one simulates the effect of these perturbations.